Good morning, everyone. We're going to start in a couple of seconds. Just everyone should please find a seat. I want to thank everyone for being here. My name is Senator Jose Serrano. I represent the 28th Senate District, and it's a wonderful honor to be joined by my counterpart in the Assembly, Assemblymember Steve Englebright. This is our second year hosting this joint committee, and I have to tell you, Assemblyman, it's a tremendous honor to have to be able to work with you and the wealth of knowledge that you bring to the issues of the arts, and I'm looking forward to another wonderful hearing here today. A little bit by way of background, many of you know me, some of you don't. I've been in the state Senate since 2005. I chair the Committee on Cultural Affairs, Tourism, Parks, and Recreation. Prior to that, I was in the New York City Council for 3 years, where I also chaired the Committee on Cultural Affairs. And prior to becoming an elected official back in 2001, I had the good fortune of working in nonprofit off-Broadway theater for 6 years. And it was my first work out of college, and it was a tremendous experience to be able to work on the audience development side of off-Broadway theater. And it really helped lay the groundwork for all of the passions that I have today in regards to the arts. So the work that I do on behalf of this committee and the work that I do with Steve really isn't work. I view it as such an honor and a privilege because this is my love and my passion. Now, having that background and with a full understanding of what the arts means, not only in New York City, where I'm from, but throughout the state, how it provides so many wonderful educational outlets and opportunities for our community, how the arts and cultural sector actually have a transformative effect on communities, as we've seen depressed communities which are now revitalizing in many ways because of the cultural sector that is growing in so many of our communities. That alone was enough to make me one of the strongest supporters of the arts. But since coming into public office, the additional benefit that I've learned is about how the arts and investment in the arts is an economic catalyst for the state of New York. How the arts generates so much in economic activity, in jobs, in other industries, tourism industries. I could go on and on and on. So those of us sitting here today, I think, are true passionates, true purists in the arts, because we believe in the effect that it has on the human life, on how it helps transform communities, and how it makes our lives that much better. But there is an additional component which I think is important as we enter budget time that can't be denied, that without the arts, we are handicapping our ability to recover from this recession. And if we cut the arts, and if we decimate arts funding, if we cut the arts to the point that they are no longer able to function in this state in a way that can pull us out of this recession, we will just prolong this recession for many, many years to come. With that, I'll conclude. You'll be hearing more from me throughout the hearing, but I want to turn it over to my co-chair here, Assemblymember Steve Englebright. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Senator Serrano. It's a great privilege to reconvene on the model of last year, which I thought gave us a chance to hear from all of the corners of the state. And I, even though we're in a blizzard today, all of these hearty souls are here to share their thoughts and to give us reinforcement and inspiration. So I just want to say thank you all for braving the weather to be here to bring your message. I associate myself with all of the comments of my colleague from the Senate. You know, New York is the state of culture. It is our greatest strength. And when you're in times of stress, go to your strength. Don't undercut your strength. And I think when you look at the institutions that are the stewards of our culture, our museums, our performing arts centers, our zoos, our botanical gardens, and our tourism promotion agencies, and our parks, they're all really part of the same cultural richness of the state. They are the institutions of optimism. And when you are in a recession, it is optimism that will bring you out of the recession. Franklin Delano Roosevelt knew that. He invested into cultural institutions. Most particularly, he helped create the great state park system that we have today during the Great Depression. We have all of these beautiful flowers of our culture. Even on snowy days like this, we have to find ways, I believe, to nurture them because they are what will lift the spirit and ultimately thereby the economy of New York. With that, I'll conclude, and I look forward to hearing the testimony from all who are here.
Thank you, Assemblyman. And yeah, it's a tremendous blizzard out there. I was noticing you have a little bit of snow on your head.
Yeah.
You just came in.
I just walked up the hill.
Yeah, and it, just to show you the commitment that we have from Assemblymember Steve Englewright, brave the snow. We've also been joined by a member of the Senate Committee on Cultural Affairs, Senator Joe Griffo, who was up until recently the ranking member on this committee. And I thank you so much for the work that you've done on behalf of Culturals and Tourism, Joe. The economic impact, I'm looking at a button here, $27.5 billion. Do we need to even think back to recent history after 9/11 in New York City when we were facing the biggest economic downturn after the attacks? What industry was it that helped pull the city out from those doldrums and actually created rapid growth in ways that we would have never fathomed? It was the cultural sector that brought New York City back to life. And we should be doing that here in New York State. We're going to be a little loose with the speaking order and the schedule today because, as the Assembly member mentioned, the weather has created a few glitches for us. A couple of Amtrak trains were turned back, but it's even more impressive the hardy souls who are here today. And we have a tremendous audience here in spite of all of the weather factors. So, we may be jumping around a little bit with the speaking order, but we're scheduled to have the executive director of NISCA, Heather Hitchens, be our first speaker, but she was one of those people on the unfortunate Amtrak train that could not make it because of the snow. So in her stead, we're very excited to have Veronica Claypool, who luckily has been in Albany since yesterday.
Exactly.
So she's going to deliver remarks on behalf of Heather, and we're eager to hear what you have to say. Go right ahead.
Thank you, Senator and Assemblyman. It's a perfect context for the New York State Council on the Arts opening remarks. In 1960, 50 years ago, Governor Nelson A. Rockefeller proposed a bold idea, public support for the arts through a state agency. Out of this vision of a society that supports and embraces artists and the creative spirit, the New York State Council on the Arts came into being as the first of its kind in the country, inspiring the development of the National Endowment for the Arts, the NEA, and other state arts agencies throughout the country. In establishing NISCA, Governor Rockefeller said, "Our cultural enterprises, whether measured in terms of their spiritual necessity or their economic pulling power, are vital to our society." He continued, "The arts are a critical measure of the quality of life, a fact that historians, if not always politicians, have recognized for centuries. We are constantly faced with combating the negative inherited problems that have become too much for any other segment of society to handle. The arts offer us a rare opportunity to further something positive, the expansion of the human capacity and the pursuit of happiness, which is, after all, not only the central element of the arts, but of good government as well. I point back to these statements today because 2010 is NISCA's 50th anniversary. And anniversaries offer valuable opportunities for reflection and a recommitment to founding visions and ideals. Before I ask you to recommit, though, I want to outline what I believe this vision has accomplished for New York State and what I think it can continue to accomplish for our state. Since its inception, NISCA has awarded more than $1.5 billion in grants to cultural organizations, large and small, in every county of the state. As a result, the state of New York has become rich with culture and has incubated and nurtured more than 5,400 not-for-profit cultural organizations and hundreds of thousands of artists that annually contribute $25.7 billion to the state's economy and an immense amount to the state's educational and social well-being. These not-for-profit cultural organizations that help make up New York State's creative economy are functioning like small businesses, employing almost 200,000 workers, attracting employers, employees, and their families to our communities, providing vital services and programs to our citizens, and generating at least $1.2 billion in state taxes annually. Therefore, let us be clear with each other, as passionate advocates and key decision makers, the arts are an undisputable source of stability for many of our communities and neighborhoods and for the state as a whole. We have the data and it speaks loudly and clearly. From Patchogue to Potsdam, from New York City to Niagara and beyond, the New York State cultural community is a living testament to the power of the arts in economic and community revitalization and to the primacy of culture in enhancing the quality of life and creating the sense of place which we cherish in our communities. Unfortunately, as we enter this anniversary year, the state is faced with unprecedented and daunting financial challenges, and NISCA has had to participate in the sacrifice that has been and will continue to be required to get the state back on solid financial footing again. Specifically, NISCA, like all state agencies, has had to implement a number of cost-saving measures in order to play its part in reducing overall costs. We have made every effort to implement these reductions in ways that minimize any adverse impact to the agency's core mission. However, they were not without pain, and we are keenly aware that the sacrifices that NISCA has had to make have in turn created the necessity for sacrifices within the cultural community. In some cases, this has created opportunities for organizations to refocus on core priorities. But in too many cases, this has meant cultural organizations going out of business, laying off employees, and canceling or reducing services that their communities have come to rely on. In fact, recent data from the Alliance for the Arts indicates that in New York City alone, 80% of cultural organizations have reduced their budgets significantly, and 50% have eliminated jobs. So here we are, in the midst of perhaps the worst financial crisis that New York State has ever endured, and it's time to consider a budget for the coming year, NISCA's 50th anniversary year. Despite all the documented accomplishments that the arts community has delivered, some people are asking the question, how can we afford to support the arts in this environment? Let me answer this question clearly. None of us come here today expecting a handout. Rather, we are here to ask that the arts community be fully galvanized to participate in the recovery of our state. We acknowledge that as a field, we still have more work to do in getting the word out and making our case to people asking this fundamental question. As we endeavor to do this, let us return to the message that Governor Rockefeller delivered when he established NISCA, and to those visions and ideals that have made New York State the arts powerhouse it is. The arts are not a burden or an extra, but an essential and powerful part of the solution, or as my colleague Virginia Lulutis from Art New York would say, the secret stimulus package that is going to help save the state of New York. Economic and community revitalization simply does not happen without the arts, as you stated. This has been documented over and over again. So the real question is, how can we not support the arts in this environment? As you consider a budget for NISCA's 50th anniversary year, I urge you to fully affirm the vision and leadership that created NISCA. While there are clearly very real and very serious practical considerations we all face, it is absolutely essential that we not get bogged down by what is and instead focus on what can be. Because what is at this moment is not what has to be, and now is simply a step on the path to something different. The fiscal year 2010-2011 NISCA budget simply must put us on the path to something different so that the state and all of its citizens can prosper and reach their full potential. Thank you.
Thank you for that message. I don't really have a question. I just want to say that the New York State Council on the Arts is at the epicenter of what I believe is the renaissance of New York, and the best days that New York will ever see, I believe, are still ahead with the arts leading the way. Council on the Arts is a very small agency. We have a $132 billion budget. The Council on the Arts budget is about $51 million. It seems to me that given the role that the Council on the Arts plays in stimulating activity on every main street in the state and lifting the spirits of our state's citizens, that it would be political malpractice for us to cut the staff by a third and cut the budget by 20%, which is what has basically been proposed. So I know that I do not speak just for myself. I speak for many, a vast majority of my colleagues in the Assembly, and thank you for bringing your message today. It reinforces just how important it is for us to continue to stimulate the arts and enable them to be all that they can be for bringing our state back to full economic health.
Thank you, and on behalf of all of my colleagues at New York State Arts Alliance and my organization, Theater Development Fund, we are here to stand with you in these challenging times.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, I know that you're here delivering remarks for Heather Hitchens, and I know that questions should probably be posed to her, but I do appreciate the testimony, and I just wanted to also mentioned that we are celebrating the 50th anniversary of NISCA and that it's the oldest arts agency in the nation, and we have a resolution that we will, in the Senate, that will commemorate the event. We'll be introducing that soon and get a copy over to NISCA. And also to echo the words of the Assembly member, Our ability to fortify our communities in many ways, especially when it comes to the arts, relies heavily on the expertise of NISCA. Your organization, Heather's organization, has the people who truly understand so much of the arts. And when we cut the way that we're cutting, proposed cuts to the NISCA budget, we seriously shortchange not only NISCA, but I think all of our communities. And when you think about what the arts has done for New York City and the missed opportunity potentially that we are experiencing for using the arts in other areas throughout the states as a source of economic generation. So I thank you for your remarks, and I want to mention that we've been joined by Senator Bill Perkins, my colleague from Harlem and East Harlem, and Senator Malcolm Smith had popped his head in for a second. I know he's running around doing a lot today. But with that, I will thank you for your remarks, and we will get on to the next panel. Thank you very much,
thank
Veronica.
You.
Next we'll hear from Edward Matino from I Love New York. And while he comes to the table, just want to tell everyone how we are using technology to the fullest. This meeting is being streamed live on the Senate webpage. I am also Twittering live. I know it's probably... you probably think I'm just writing emails, but I'm actually doing some live tweeting here as we hear testimony. Also, we have solicited questions via YouTube. So we have a number of pieces of testimony and questions that have been submitted by video on YouTube. Assemblymember Steve Englebright and I will... After this hearing, we'll sit down, go through all of them, and we will respond to each and every one and post our videos in response to their questions. So I think it's a wonderful dialogue. We're using all methods of media here. So with that, I'll stop and I'll turn it over to Edward. Thank you very much for being with us.
Of course. Good morning, Chairman Serrano, Chairman Englebright, and distinguished members of the legislature. I appreciate having been invited to the committee's Arts Day hearing, representing the Department of Economic Development's Division of Marketing, Advertising, and Tourism. As the division's managing director, I can certainly speak to the importance of arts and culture as a driver of tourism and economy in New York State. However, I'd like to start with something less quantifiable. As a lifelong New Yorker who has experienced nearly everything our state has to offer, from Museum Mile to Music on the Green in Woodstock, to living history in Crown Point, I recognize the richness arts and culture bring to our everyday lives and want to especially commend your efforts to sustain and promote these core state assets. As you well know, the tourism industry is an essential part of New York State's economy, generating $54 billion in annual spending, $7 billion in state and local taxes, and supporting nearly 700,000 jobs. While we face an unprecedented economic downturn, our mandate remains the same. Promote New York State travel across all 11 tourism regions and thousands of tourism destinations through advertising, public relations, marketing, private-public partnerships, and brand management. In every facet of our mandate, the promotion of arts and culture plays a prominent role. Allow me to provide some details in a very tactical sense. This spring, I Love New York is introducing its newly designed website, www.iloveNewYork.com, which will engage consumers on a much deeper level about New York State attractions, including arts and cultural destinations. Our web content has always connected visitors with information about museums, arts, cultural events, and destinations through a series of relevant listings. The new site will go even farther to more clearly display New York State arts and culture. For example, the new site will feature a 50s institution in 50 weeks promotion that spotlights hundreds of literary, performing arts, and visual arts destinations to celebrate the New York State Council on the Arts 50th anniversary. Phase two of the website will include video clips based on celebrity endorsement of New York State arts. The new site includes an eclectic mix of featured topic pages whose themes range from antiques and architecture and design to arts and crafts, film festivals, history and culture, music, the New York State Fair, people and cultures, performing arts, and theater. These pages highlight related attractions and visitor information, making sure that web users learn about opportunities to experience New York State arts and cultures. In addition to this featured content, overall site content is updated seasonally to reflect relevant arts and cultural events and attractions. For example, in summer, we focus on historic mansions and outdoor festivals. In winter, we focus on museums and holiday performances. We also support arts and cultural destinations and events by producing public service announcements and social media outlets, including I Love New York's Facebook and Twitter pages. In fact, 114 out of the 868 total tweets to date, or 13%, have been focused on arts and culture. Finally, arts and culture are included in each piece of collateral material produced by I Love New York. This year, we have a prominent 4-6-page arts feature in the 2010 travel guide. The state's Tourism Matching Funds and Explore New York programs have been a rich source of funding for counties to promote their arts and cultural destinations and events. Statewide, these dollar-for-dollar matching grants leverage over $8 million annually. Explore New York Round 2, in particular, had a strong arts and cultural proof point. 9 out of the 26 projects, or 35%, were arts and cultural based. Some grants projects approved by I Love New York include the James Fenimore Cooper Home overlooking Oswego Lake, a quilting campaign over 40 barns and buildings with wooden quilt blocks displayed through rural countryside in Orleans County, and Sullivan County's 40th anniversary of the Woodstock Music and Art Fair. Public relations remains one of I Love New York's strongest resources to promote the state's tourism assets. This is particularly true while budget cuts have limited our ability to advertise. In 2009 and 2010, arts and culture have been a central to consumer message through a combination of press releases, media events and outreach, specialized marketing, and partnerships. In 2009, total earned media for arts and cultural stories alone was over $1.6 million with a 120 million audience reach. The division's Media Service Bureau and Public Relations Agency, Lou Hammond and Associates, drafted and distributed various press releases highlighting New York's arts and cultural offerings, including Undiscovered Treasures, the 225th anniversary of the French and Indian War, hands-on cultural experiences around the state, and the maple sugaring industry. The agency coordinated group and individual media visits with itineraries focusing on arts and culture, including the Thousand Islands, Finger Lakes, and Capital Saratoga regions, and executed unique and successful special events, including the James Beard Media Luncheon and the Canadian media efforts in Toronto, Ottawa, and Montreal. The division also heavily supported the Hudson Quadcentennial celebration, highlighting cultural events surrounding the celebration. The quad efforts alone resulted in an earned media ad value of over $1 million and nearly 38 million impressions, including an in-depth Associated Press story with national reach, a USA Today cover story, and an NBC Nightly News story that reached over 9 million homes. In 2009, I Love New York relied on digital and print advertising to drive potential visitors to our website, focusing on a new theme and promotion each season. Each of these campaigns promoted arts and cultural assets, including upstate itineraries highlighting arts, cultural destinations and events, and our fall campaigns linked to the Quad celebration and focus on the historic significance of the discovery of the Hudson River to support statewide travel. In 2010, I Love New York is currently developing creative for a 30-second TV spot and is hopeful to use tie-ins to arts and culture where appropriate and leverage some of the state's best-known talent. As part of our partnership with the Arts Council celebrating the Year of the Arts, I Love New York is working with the Governor's Office to identify celebrity ambassadors for the arts. Last year, in partnership with the Governor's Office of Motion Picture and Television Development, we launched a student film contest with NYU's Tisch Film School, or School of Film. The films branded New York as a fun, adventurous place to visit and positioned the state as one of its characters in the film. The winning films will be launched on our website and included a viral video campaign. In 2008, I Love New York ran a short film contest and partnered with various New York celebrities, including Tina Fey, Philip Seymour Hoffman, and America Ferrera, to promote the winning films. In 2009, I Love New York partnered with Twilight star and New York native Peter Facinelli on a contest tied to the launch of I Love New York's Twitter page. The contest included a sweepstakes to visit Peter on the set of Nurse Jackie, which is taped in New York. The promotion was a huge success. Our Twitter page quickly became the number one state tourism page in the country and now has over 17,000 followers. I Love New York has also recently sponsored a sweepstakes getaway tied to the release of the film Taking Woodstock in association with Focus Films and the American Movie Channel, and continues to partner with New York's PBS in various ways, including a successful sponsorship of Ken Burns' 2009 documentary on America's national parks, which resulted in 10 original vignettes highlighting New York cultural assets played on 7 PBS stations across the state. Finally, the Division of Tourism has a long history of having senior management level representation on various arts and cultural commissions and committees, including the French and Indian War Commission, the Quad Commission, the Appalachian Regional Commission, the Museum Association of New York, the Historical Association, the Hudson River Valley National Heritage Area, the Mohawk Heritage Corridor, and the Seaway Trail. As you can see, promoting New York's arts and cultural destinations and events has been a central focus in I Love New York's tourism marketing efforts. We will continue to work with our partners in and out of state government to ensure that New York's great art and cultural institutions, destinations, and events remain a vital part of the state's economy and relevant to all New Yorkers. Thank you for inviting me here today.
Thank you very much. Edward, I have one question before I turn it over to my colleague. It seems like these cuts, we just heard about cuts to NISCA, and the cuts to I Love New York are sort of a double whammy for the arts and chipping away. And it's this chipping effect that I think is so detrimental. But this double whammy of cuts to both areas. And if these cuts are enacted, how will that affect your ability to promote the arts throughout the state?
Well, that's a good question. Our budget has been trending down for the last 3 years from 18 million to 12 to last year. The 9 and 10 budget was $8 million. And we don't know what's over the hill, but like I say, it's trending down. So what we've tried to do is really focus on 3 or 4 core areas that we can amplify all the destinations and all the tourism attractions that New York State has to offer. The web certainly has been a big part of our efforts. We put a tremendous amount of time and effort and money into relaunching the new website, which is due next month. And we hope that it's going to be a very engaging and lively website for 2010 and on. Working with Assemblyman Engelbright and some others, we've been looking at redoing our creative, which has in past years kind of focused on print and digital in support of our new website. So we haven't been up on the air in advertising since 2006, so we're really very much looking forward to getting back on TV. With that said, I'm not sure what the budget's going to allow us to do as far as a media buy, but I think it's important that we do get back on TV, particularly upstate, to let everybody know I Love New York is alive and well.
One other point before I turn it over, because you're talking about getting your message out there. One of the things that you know that we're working on here in the legislature is creating this C-SPAN-like channel statewide, NISPAN, or
right.
Some other name that we're going to call it. We're continuing to work with the cable industry and other folks here in Albany to try to get this statewide channel up and running. And I've been co-chairing with Senator Bonasik in the Assembly and Ron Canister, Senator Bonasik on the other side of the aisle and Ron Canister in the Assembly to get this channel up and running. And one of the, I think, most interesting components of what we want to do here, aside from openness in government and broadcasting legislation and committee meetings statewide, but also giving airtime for tourism promotional spots. because there are so many great places throughout the state, so many cultural attractions that a lot of folks just don't know about, from other, depending where you are. And I think that this will be another important vehicle to getting that together. Your thoughts on that channel?
No, I think that's a great idea, and we're working on a staff level to provide content on that channel. And what I think is particularly important about that is that as this economy has kind of bottomed out and travelers aren't making these long trips anymore, it's even more important to make sure that we use every possible means that we can to promote New York State travel. So there's 80 million people within a five-hour drive of New York, and so if we can get that content up and running on the cable station, it'll be a great reminder to a lot of people planning vacations that you can stay right here. So it works well.
Thank you.
And anything free, we'll take.
Exactly.
Good morning, Ned. Thank you for your testimony. I just have two questions. I'm remembering the original ads on television. I'm glad to hear you say that you're looking at television, even though we have some limits in this budget, as a vehicle. The original ads included quite prominently in many cases, donated time of individuals who appeared on Broadway and whole casts. In the case, I remember one commercial that was done by Katz, but the entire staff and the entire cast was part of that commercial. They were powerful. Having Frank Sinatra sing I Love New York on a I Love New York commercial, you know, is very memorable. I know that the Broadway League has reached out and that there have been some discussions. I wonder if you could tell us where those discussions are at and if we're making progress on rekindling the magic of the nexus between Broadway and I Love New York.
Well, that's you know, really true, Assemblyman. They were very iconic spots that I think helped define the brand back in the 70s. And we are looking to do kind of a reset of those using some more modern stars and New Yorkers. We're working with the governor's office right now, who has concurrently been trying to do this ambassadors for New York. And we've been working and talking with some managers and talent people for a variety of different stars and really kind of iconic New Yorkers. So we hope to fit that in and help brand New York with these stars, and Broadway certainly in the discussion, because they were fantastic commercials. They really were.
I'm glad to hear that you're working on that. I think it's really important.
Yeah.
My second question, you know, we have three great park systems in this state. We have the zoos, botanical gardens, aquariums, and nature preserves of the private not-for-profit world. Those zoological and botanical parks are world-class destinations. We have the Great Adirondack Park, and we have the Department of Environmental Conservation overseeing a de facto park system of conservation sites. And then we have the actual officially designated New York State Park System, which includes the original State Park, Niagara Reservation in 1885, and the original first in the nation State Historic Site, Washington's headquarters in Newburgh. And there are great potentials, I believe, to utilize that park system to help staycation trend. We saw last year, even during the economic downturn, 2 million more visitors to the state park system than in the prior year. And it just seems to me that this is a matrix of public and not-for-profit owned public spaces that will, if properly nurtured, bring our population out to learn more about the state and get a better sense of place and a greater sense of pride than if they stay at home. And I'm just wondering, is I Love New York looking at that potential and working toward maximizing it?
Well, you know, I'm glad you asked me that, because we, one of our major, again, because we don't have a really large budget, we have to kind of, you know, tool our marketing and kind of pare it down to what we believe is our strongest, you know, assets. So what we've been planning all through 2009 and what we're beginning to execute this spring and summer, beginning on Earth Day in April 22nd, is a major green initiative, working with the governor's office and Parks and Rec, Ag and Markets, and some of our sister agencies. And we've come up with these 10 iconic green destinations, trying to tap into the, you know, the growing green market, but in a larger sense to also use our I Love New York red heart, turning it green, and to kind of elevating a new kind of consciousness on sustainability. So it's a major marketing tool for us this year. And it's our strongest proof point is going to be parks. And we're starting with the 125th anniversary of Niagara Falls State Park, which I'm happy to hear is going to stay open. That's kind of important. And we are planning all these different destinations, and we're going to have travel writers and social media and not so much of an advertising budget, but certainly a major focus of our public relations this year is going to be around these 10 iconic trips that we can take from Niagara Falls to the Adirondacks. It's going to be across the season, so New Yorkers can experience some of the great adventures of all these parks throughout the year, culminating in the winter, where we can do some snowshoeing and some events that are green-related. Part of it is tied into a new eco-certified program that we're working with NCON with. And we have currently a pilot program for hotels, which have 44 green certified hotels through the Audubon International, and also hundreds of green certified restaurants that we're working on. So the idea is to take these green icons, and it's going to touch all 11 tourism regions of the state, and build these itineraries around them where you can stay in a green hotel and eat at two or three green restaurants, and visit some organic farms or certified spas or any other green assets that we have. And again, a strong element of that will be our parks and our heritage corridors and all the other great natural assets that New York possesses. And in fact, I think one of them is Fire Island in Long Island.
Thank you for your message, and we really appreciate you taking the time in the snowstorm to come here to share it with us. Thank you.
My pleasure, Senator.
Thank you. We have one more question from Senator Bill Perkins.
Let's see. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for this opportunity. And thank you for your testimony. You know, for me, the most significant part of your testimony was the recognition of the richness arts and culture bring to our everyday lives and the need to sustain and to promote this. I know that it apparently contributes about $28 billion to our economy, but that richness is probably much greater than that, and obviously in many respects is immeasurable. I'm particularly interested in what's happening around I Love New York and what you're doing as it relates to young people in terms of bringing them into what you do. You know, they spend a lot of money, by the way, mm-hmm. and are very much a driver of our economy in their own ways. And so are we engaged in specific projects, messaging that will recognize their importance? Are we involved in the schools or in some other areas that would be that you can speak on right now?
Well, great question, Senator. You know, of course, as far as the schools go, there are some really fine, you know, undergrad and graduate programs in tourism in the state that we've got great partnerships with. But in the larger sense, I mean, what our agency does is we're very consumer-driven. So it is a large market, young you know, the young, I would say, you know, 20 to 30s. It's a great market that we're trying to capture, and that's why we
launched. I would go even younger.
Even younger, okay. Well, we're trying to use Facebook and Twitter, which we launched last year, to great success. And we're also trying to use some, you know, leverage some of the great stars that we have, like this Peter Facinelli, who I have to admit I didn't really hear much about, but I guess he's got a following of over a million on Twitter. And he brought just a tremendous amount of enthusiasm, his following, to New York. So, you know, social media certainly is a way to stay relevant with young kids. And we just got into it at the end of last year. And again, our resources are very thin. I wish we, you know, had somebody that we could dedicate full time to it. But thank God we do have a staffer who's interested in it, so does tweets on weekends and nights, and kind of keeps it going 24 hours a day for us.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Jay-Z, but not Peter Facinelli.
Well, Peter Facinelli, yeah.
Facinelli.
Yeah, well, you got to watch Twilight, Senator.
Excuse me?
He's the dad in Twilight. Twilight?
Okay, Twilight. Okay. Okay. So, great. I think I'm glad to hear that we're moving in that direction. But there are, you know, others that are native New Yorkers that are huge in terms of the youth culture.
Right.
That I think if we're going to go back to the I Love New York, advertising would probably be useful in terms of making connections where they may not have been made in the past.
That's a good point. Hmm? That's a good point.
Yeah. So I just wanted to make that suggestion. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much, Edward, for your testimony, and continue working with you on these issues. Thank you.
Thanks, Senator.
Next, we're going to, the next panel that we have is a arts and tourism panel, and unfortunately, our first speaker, Paul Lippin, from the Broadway League, he's the chair of the Broadway League, is one of the today's casualties of the snowstorm. So unfortunately, he's not with us, but we will hear from Dan Murphy, who's the president of the New York State Hospitality and Tourism Association, and looking forward to hearing what Dan has to say. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you, Senator. Assemblyman Englebright, senators and assembly members. I'm going to turn that both ways. And I brought along a little bag here that symbolizes the fact these are silver dollars wrapped in gold. They're chocolates, but visitors generate $7 billion in state and local taxes to our tax coffers, tax revenue to our tax coffers annually. And we'll be distributing these to all of your peers next Tuesday on March the 2nd, which would be our Tourism Action Day, again, to help drive home the importance of the economic benefit of tourism to our great state. So thank you for allowing me to speak this morning to this Joint Committee on Arts Day regarding the economic development budget included in the 2010-2011 executive budget proposal, specifically the I Love New York Tourism Marketing Fund and the Tourism Matching Funds programs and their impact on the spirit, the culture, and the integrity of our great state. By way of background, the New York State Hospitality and Tourism Association is the oldest lodging association in the country, and we were founded in Saratoga Springs in 1887. We have nearly 1,400 members, primarily businesses and individuals in the lodging and attractions industry, and we represent about 70% of the total lodging room inventory in the state. I also serve as the administrator of the Tourism Industry Coalition, which we have 19 private sector industry organizations with tourism as its core product. Some of the members include the Hotel Association of New York City, the Long Island CBB and Sports Commission, the Museum Association of New York, NYC and Company, the New York State Association of CBBs, the New York State Restaurant Association, and in today, with today's weather, the happiest probably association here in the state, the ski areas of New York. So I would like to thank Senator Serrano and Assemblyman Engelbreit for hosting this meeting on this very important topic. Assemblyman Engelbreit and Senator Serrano have been a great resource, and we look forward to working to restore New York to its place as the number one destination in America. The economic benefit provided to the state by the tourism industry is unparalleled. However, that is not the only contribution the tourism industry makes to New York. The significant cultural and historical treasures of our state provide the foundations that the tourism industry markets to those who will appreciate and enjoy them, spreading the cultural reach of the great state of New York. And it is with great pride that the tourism industry displays New York to the world, and it is with great confidence that the tourism industry asks for help in doing so. The businesses that make up the tourism industry understand the economic crisis facing the state and ask that it look to the tourism industry for a smart investment that will not only provide economic benefit but bolster the spirit and pride of the state. We urge the legislature to at least maintain the current funding levels for I Love New York and the Tourism Matching Grant Program of $14.6 million. Smart investment. Funding tourism should not be viewed as an expense, but it is an investment. When funding is provided to local tourism marketing programs, for example, they attract visitors to a region that benefit not only hotels, but the entire community. As patrons eat in restaurants, spend in the shops, and visit the destinations. In each of these instances, the state and local taxes are providing return on that investment. Tourism contributes to every sector of the economy in each region of our state. And the cultural and historical treasures of our state are the key components in attracting that visitor and having that visitor possibly stay the extra day, that additional day, and generate that extra economic benefit to our state because of their interest in our cultural and historical treasures. As an investment, the tourism industry is a safe one that will provide a 7-to-1 return. While the down economy does present a problem, it also provides an opportunity. People continue to travel, but not as far, just as you were speaking earlier to Ed Matano here of I Love New York. People continue to travel, but they don't go as far, in that millions of people in the Northeast will look to New York, their own backyard, for their leisure destination, and the tourism industry can provide the marketing and promotional expertise to ensure that this state is featured as the attractive destination that it is. While a reduction in overall state spending is imperative, it is also necessary to make investments that will return revenue and economic benefit, and the tourism industry is that investment. Revenue generator. According to recent statistics from Tourism Economics, an Oxford economic company, tourism is a vital component of New York State's economy. In 2008, visitors spent $53 billion. 684,000 jobs were sustained by visitors to New York State, with an associated income of $27 billion. 6.2% of all jobs in the state are sustained by tourism. And tourism in New York State generated $7 billion in state and local taxes. Immediate return. The findings also show that investing in tourism leads to an immediate increase in economic activity in all regions of the state. The studies have shown that few industries benefit faster from consumer marketing than tourism. Fewer industries create more jobs per $1 million of economic activity than tourism and produce tax revenue at a higher rate. Tourism can be the cornerstone of a budget that will begin the recovery of our state's economy. A reliable investment with quick returns, tourism also contributes to many other sectors of the economy. So tourism not only provides billions of dollars in tax revenue, but it also creates jobs. Studies have shown in the last 20 years, tourism jobs have increased by over 22%, compared to an increase of less than 6% for the rest of the private sector employment. And regions around the state rely on employment that tourism provides. As an employer, between 6 and 17% of the people in each region of our state, demonstrating its integral place in the economy of each region. The state has many programs that are aimed at creating jobs. Tourism does just that. Marketing tourism is critical. The state has many destinations, yet it is up to the tourism industry to ensure the traveling public is made aware of these destinations. Packaging information, advertising, and marketing are cultural and historic treasures. The entertainment, the shopping, the natural scenery, and special events is critical to creating that awareness and demand for our destinations. Tourism marketing programs in particular are the investment that result in visitor spending, which in turn results in the much-needed tax revenues. So as proud New Yorkers that believe we have a collection of destinations unlike any other, marketing promotion of them is a labor of love that requires state leadership and investment. The funding level has been reduced in each of the last three-year budget cycles, as just previously shared by Ed Matano, including last year's deficit reduction plan. And it is now at risk of being cut even more. The tourism industry looks to the chairs and members of the committees here to lead and be a voice in support of tourism funding. Any reduction to the state's tourism marketing budget this year would place us at a competitive disadvantage as we compete with neighboring states for the travelers' top-of-mind awareness. Marketing for tourism is about spreading the spirit, the culture, and the history of our state, and it comes with economic benefits that provides for its continued support, economic benefits that require state investment. We hope that funding for tourism is maintained so that the state can remain a pinnacle in American culture, the number one destination in the state that everyone loves, while creating jobs and replenishing our much depleted tax coffers. So thank you very much for allowing me to share that today.
Thank you. Thanks, Dan. I had the good fortune of seeing you up in Syracuse back in the fall, and I was up there hosting a series of arts roundtables up in the Syracuse area and meeting the wonderful arts community out in Syracuse and how they continue to provide economic engine for that area. And in listening to your testimony, it's funny, I hear these numbers over and over, but every time I hear them, I'm even more astounded and by them. $53 billion in economic activity. Did I hear you correctly when you said that?
That's correct. $53 billion.
And 6.2% of all jobs statewide or somehow, and we're talking about Broadway.
We're talking from Broadway up to a housekeeper up in the Adirondacks or a tour guide in the Adirondacks, someone out on Long Island at one of the beaches, any one of those categories that feels the impact of tourism and visitors coming into their area, whether it be someone just on a pushcart or whether it be the manager of a hotel, restaurant, or a ski area.
Mm-hmm. I recall when I was working in theater, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, first thing I learned was that for every one person you see performing, every performance artist, there are about 50 to 100 people behind the scenes with jobs in that industry. In a theater in particular, you have the house staff, carpenters, set designers, costume designers, and these are real careers. These are wonderful careers. And you're right, these are jobs that are very viable jobs that provide benefits, that provide livelihoods for folks. So it's not just the artists, but it's so many countless other people who are not artists but work within the arts and cultural tourism industries, as you mentioned. Just one side note I want to mention before I turn it over to the assembly member is that Paul Lippin from the Broadway League, who was going to be here, was going to have a DVD presentation. We didn't think we were going to have that, but the DVD has arrived. So as soon as we're done here, we will be seeing a quick DVD presentation. Assembly member?
That's great. And Senator, but to your remark exactly, we see that actor or actress on the stage, but the literal hundreds of people in the back of the house that make that happen. The same applies to a lot of our tourism venues. So those are the true unrecognized heroes in our industry. Thank you.
Dan, I just want to congratulate you on the positive message that you've just delivered. I think it should be on television in a public service announcement spot. I wonder, is it possible for us to borrow the copy that you have read from so that we might have a copy for our records?
Yes, we have submitted my testimony.
That's wonderful. I think it's critically important for us to take a look at ways to strengthen the tourism industry and to strengthen the cross connections, as you have rightly pointed out, which are so much a part of the culture and history of this state, between our cultural institutions, performing arts organizations and artists, and our parks and the historic sites. I pledge to work with you to help do that. Thank you for your leadership. Thank you for your message here today.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you all.
Thank you. Now we will see the DVD. And as a side note, I don't know if it's in the paperwork that everyone will receive, but we have a number of special guests that are going to be joining us throughout this hearing today. It's an arts and culture hearing, so you know it's got to be exciting. So we can roll the DVD now. You know, technology is not a perfect science yet. But, you know, as all actors on stage, we will act out everything that was going to be on this DVD. I'll just leave that. Well, what we'll do is move on to something of equal excitement. We're going to hear from the Coalition of Living Museums. And this is Aaron Buska with a special guest. Okay.
Right now.
Okay.
So, if I may.
Good afternoon. My name is not Lois Carswell. Lois is also stuck in transit and couldn't make it, but she sends her regards. I am sort of acting secretary of the Coalition of Living Museums. Joining me today are colleagues from many living museums in New York City and around the state: Queens Botanical Garden, New York Botanical Garden, Greenberg Nature Center, folks from Long Island, etc. On behalf of all 112 living museums operating in 44 counties of New York State, I must first thank Chairman Engelbreit, Chairman Serrano, and all the members of this committee for their steadfast leadership and unshakable vision during these challenging times. I also applaud the leadership and support of Assemblymember Sweeney and Senator Antoine Thompson, who are also true champions of the Coalition's environmental literacy mission. Without your commitment to living museums, especially during these last two tumultuous years, many of our organizations would not be in operation today. I'm here to voice alarm about the executive's disproportionate and short-sighted cuts to the Environmental Protection Fund and the New York State Office of Parks, Recreation, and Historic Preservation. Should these proposed cuts be enacted into law, the effects will further weaken the economic recovery of New York State, threaten our tourism industry that, as we've heard, is the envy of every state in the union, and turn back the clock on environmental literacy in public schools throughout the Empire State. Before I introduce our feathered friend, who has ridden up, not flown up, from Westchester, and in the interest of time, I would like to share with this committee the three asks living museums have been discussing with your colleagues in the legislature. The first is to oppose the executive's 45% proposed reduction to ZBGA in the state fiscal year 10-11, restoring ZBGA as the core environmental protection program for environmental literacy and ecotourism. The chairman, both being champions of this program, are well aware of the almost 3 to 4 million school children that we serve in New York City alone collectively, and the other millions throughout the state. For over 30 years, the economic and environmental benefits have been well produced. My colleague Janet Torres is going to highlight on that in a minute. The second ask that we've also been making to your colleagues is to restore operational funding for the Department of Parks, Recreation, and Historic Preservation so that service reductions and closure of state parks may be avoided. As many people know here, under the leadership of Commissioner Ash, ZBGA has been expertly administered, and we are grateful for the agency's support. We hear from the agency that they've been forced to make some difficult decisions, and we would like to support them. With over 56 million visitors a year, our state park system are truly the gem of the nation, and anything that we can do as a coalition with all of our living museums statewide, we would be like to be at the forefront on that. Our last point that we've been making to your colleagues, and this has resounded very well, is protecting the integrity of the Environmental Protection Fund. We believe that the dedicated revenue stream from the real estate transfer tax can still support a $222 million environmental protection fund and can provide restorations to some of those programs that were zeroed out this year that also have demonstrable economic benefits and help our state in tourism and that sort of thing. Particularly when so many of them came to our aid last year when the governor proposed a zeroing out of ZBGA, we also want to be supportive of those programs moving forward. I know that this committee in particular acknowledges that living museums, state parks, and many of the programs of the Environmental Protection Fund play an important and unique role in the education of our youth and the health of New York State's environment and economy. I look forward to working with you, continue to work with all of you to protect these resources New Yorkers know and love. Thank you for your time today. I'm going to ask if our special guest is available yet. I think that it is. Janet, can you stick your head out? We are joined by Mr. Kurt Hungen, who is the executive director of Greenberg Nature Center in Scarsdale, and he has traveled with a guest who is coming here for our hearing today.
On behalf of all the ZBGA members, I'd like to introduce one of our living members. This is Madison. This here is a 3-year-old female red tail. These are probably one of the most abundant raptors in your state. You can find them all across the country, up into Canada. And obviously they get their name from the red tail they have. But the question is really, is why did we bring this bird up today? And the real reason is that these birds and other animals and plants really are our lifeblood. At the Greenberg Nature Center, what we're able to do is bring this bird out into education programs, both in-house and out-house. And what it allows us to do is it allows us to provide a live animal for education. And there's nothing more powerful than that to get the attention of kids, get the attention of adults. It really makes a big difference. And in the case of this particular bird, what we'll do is we'll use it for adaptations. If you look, for example, on this bird, talons, beaks, and eyes for raptors are very, very important. But again, I think the other important thing for us is that it's a tool that allows us to do what we do, and that really is to educate the public, you know, adults and children about the importance of the environment, the importance of conservation, and which really leads to a quality of life issue, I think, for all New Yorkers. So I'd just like to thank you for allowing us to bring it up. And if you have any, if anybody's got any questions, please let me know. All right.
Thanks, Chris.
Okay.
Wow, that's beautiful. Thank you so much for bringing Madison here. Let's hear from Madison.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you for bringing the special guest, one of several today. Janet, you're up.
Good morning. Torres. My name is Janet Torres, and I represent the Wildlife Conservation Society, and we represent the Bronx Zoo New York Aquarium, and we are a member of the Coalition of Living Museums. Thank you, Senator Serrano. Thank you, Assemblymember Engelbreit, for the opportunity today to present our video testimony. I hope we can show it today. On how the governor's proposed budget cuts would affect zoos, botanical gardens, aquariums across New York State. The video you will see today takes a look into the near future if the governor's cut to ZBGA goes into effect for fiscal year 2011. So basically 2 days after you pass the budget, if that's, you know, becomes true. One last thing I want to mention, because I want the video to speak for itself. And basically I'm here to talk about the economic part of it, the jobs. But one last thing I wanted to share with you and the committee here. I want to mention that with this video, WCS and the Coalition of Living Museums has launched a statewide petition drive campaign against the devastating cuts of all 80 zoos, botanical gardens, and aquariums with the governor's proposed budget cut of 45%. As of Monday, we had over 19,474 messages have been sent to the governor. And to representatives statewide. This, we feel, last year was a great opportunity for us to educate not only the legislature, the governor, but also the people of New York State on the importance of living museums. You may see our buttons, you know, Save ZBGA. You may look at the video and say, oh, it's the Bronx Zoo, but that's representative. We're representing all of the coalition members here. We're from Niagara out to Suffolk County. We are the economic drivers and stabilizers of local communities. So we are here today to speak about culture and arts, but also, as you have both pointed out and have been our champions for the last year, that we are part of the economy, that without this piece and a piece of everyone here, and we're very honored to be part of Art Day, is this piece of jobs in the economy. So I will let the video speak for itself, and if you have any questions, I will be happy to answer them. Thank you again.
Great. Thank you, Janet.
I've got a package here for a Doris.
Oh, yeah, right this way. To reassign some staff. Yeah. You notice a lot of changes around here. Roy, I'll see you for lunch. You know, Albany cut our budget by almost 50%, and that includes all 80 zoos, botanical gardens, and aquariums.
Hello, think about you.
What are you gonna do? At the end of the day, we still need to provide thousands of jobs for local communities, educate the next generation of conservationists, and generate millions of dollars for the state in tourism and economic development. We'll do what we can. We can't do it all. Doris? Watch out for the tortoise. Can you sign for this?
So as that video has demonstrated, this is, like I said, would happen 2 days after a budget that would include the governor's proposed cut. It's a short video. It's gone viral. We've had almost 4,000 hits on YouTube. And we really do feel that as part of our grassroots advocacy campaign, this is what is getting the attention of the public. And with this, individuals will be able to sign the petition and send a message to their local legislature and to the governor. But it's short, it's sweet, it gets to the point. The Coalition Living Museums, over 12 million visitors across the state to these organizations, providing jobs, like I said, stabilizing local communities. And it's not just the jobs each of our institutions provide, but what do we do as a multiplier effect for those in the local community? So the vendors for us in the Bronx and in Brooklyn that we work with, the MWBEs that we work with, the local restaurants that benefit from Arthur Avenue, for instance. So I think it's a great example of what we want, and I hope that video, when you have time to take a look at it later on, I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Serrano. Just leaned over a moment ago to remind me that we really do not want to have the Baghdad Zoo in New York, and that the kinds of cuts that are being proposed go directly at taking away food and forage and curatorial care for the living collections. And as we saw, when there is war, sometimes those collections suffer terribly. This isn't a war. We are the Empire State, and we are a great state, and we should not allow the responsibilities that we have to the, in many cases, endangered species that you care for, your living collections, to be placed at risk or to be taken away from our public. You are the site that prepares the next generation for their stewardship responsibilities for the environment. So we're going to fight for you.
Thank you.
And we thank you for bringing your message here. Keep those cards and letters going to your legislators all throughout the state, and of course to the governor's office as well.
We will definitely let both of your offices know as we continue. Our goal is 25,000 messages, but as soon as we, you know, as we start hitting those numbers, we will keep your both offices informed. So thank you very much for your leadership and your support, and we appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, we are going to hear from our third panel, which is the Arts and Economic Development. And we'll hear from Martin Jacobs, Director of Near West Side Initiative. Okay. And Janet Rodriguez. No. Is Janet Rodriguez here?
No.
Okay. Got it. Okay, so we're going to hear from Martin. And we're actually, because we're having such a great time here, we're actually starting to run low on time. So I'm going to ask all of the testifiers to please try to limit their testimony to around 3 minutes. Thank you very much, Martin. You may begin.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity. As mentioned, I'm Martin Jacobs, the director of the New York Side Initiative revitalization effort taking place in Syracuse, New York. So we're very accustomed to the weather occurring outside today. My organization is affiliated with Syracuse University, and we're seeing what a strong economic driver the arts can be in an otherwise often struggling post-industrial city. The New West Side of Syracuse is a classic example of a post-industrial neighborhood. It's been lined by empty warehouses and filled with vacant and abandoned properties, and the community has long fallen into a deep poverty. However, in the last several years, the neighborhood is seeing a revival, and it's one that is largely spurred on by the arts.
Oh, there you go. The Near West Side Initiative was developed in 2006 with the intent of revitalizing the neighborhood by infusing it with arts and technology. By working with the current residents and stakeholders in the community, local artists and prospective artists, we are able to create a comprehensive and collaborative approach to revitalize the neighborhood by drawing on the arts as the economic catalyst to spark the neighborhood into full-fledged revitalization. This program has since taken on the name of the SALT District, standing for Syracuse Art, Life, and Technology, while also speaking to the past history of the SALT fields that were prevalent in the neighborhood and all around Syracuse. Today, through the SALT District, the neighborhood is quickly becoming host to numerous artists, art organizations, and artist-based institutions. Located in the neighborhood, we now have two large art studio spaces that combined hold over 80 artist studios at affordable rates. In addition, we have our first local artist-in-residence, Juan Cruz, and a multitude of live-work properties ideal for artists to renovate into studios and homes. These opportunities, combined with the advantages of living in a smaller-scale city like Syracuse with a low cost of living while still having access to all the Northeast arts markets such as New York City, Toronto, Boston, and Washington, D.C., is creating a true hotbed for young and emerging artists. In turn, the neighborhood and the greater Syracuse area is seeing the benefits from this growth in the arts community. Thanks to this new emerging energy, we are seeing a significant new investment in the neighborhood. Last year, King Architecture Firm moved their headquarters into the neighborhood from the surrounding suburb, and thanks to that move, 30-plus employees are now spending money in the neighborhood and the downtown establishments. Likewise, an additional warehouse is in the process of being converted into 10 artist loft-style apartments, and although not finished yet, we already have over 20 requests for a copy of the lease. Similarly, a previously large abandoned warehouse is in the initial phase of being converted into the future home of WCNY, our local broadcasting company, which will once again bring significant investment into the neighborhood and downtown. As a result of these investments, all spurred on by the efforts of emerging artists moving into the neighborhood, neighborhood businesses are flourishing and new businesses are beginning to pop up, such as fitness studios, a dry cleaning service, small clothing boutiques, cafe, and art supply store. So as evidenced by the SALT District, the arts hold tremendous power in regards to the community and economic development of our neighborhood. Arts is more than a tool to simply beautify a neighborhood or to engage youth in arts. While these are obviously important and great things happening in our community, it is imperative that we view the arts for what it is, a catalytic power that has the ability to radically alter the economic climate of a community. And with that, I will close. And so thank you for your time.
That was not to meant to be the hook.
No, that was the opening song.
Yeah,
no.
The snow affects all the technology. Here. Blame it on the snow. Thank you very much for your testimony. As I mentioned earlier, I was up in Syracuse and I was so impressed with how the arts community is working together, different folks working together to build a very strong community. And I wanted to ask you, as funding from NISCA is down, and presumably art sales are down when you're facing a recession in the economy, what has this done to your arts community, and has the arts community been able to come together and form a new generation of creative minds, or has the cuts really decimated the community, or potentially can it decimate the community at this point?
Yeah, I think the beauty of the arts community is they're creative and they're all entrepreneurs, so everyone is doing their best to try
and
find.
And pretty resilient as well.
Absolutely. And just like with the Near West Side, are the first to take the chance of living in an area that's maybe suffered and therefore has opportunities for lower cost living. But also we're just working together and are collaborative in finding funding together and supporting each other's artwork and moving along. So a lot of our studio spaces and things like that we have, we've seen artists really collaborate on things and do fundraisers for each other's art shows and things like that to keep it moving.
Well, thank you very much for your testimony, and we look forward to continuing to work with you.
Great. And I think we also submitted a YouTube video, so you'll see a little bit of what we've been doing there as well.
Okay, are we seeing that later?
Yep.
Right, we're going to have a YouTube presentation with clips of a few. We're going to see those in a few minutes. Now we're moving on to group number 4, which is arts education, which is a very important issue for myself and Assemblymember Englebright. We're going to be hearing first, I believe, from students from Arts Westchester. Is that correct? They here? Nope.
No.
Okay. So we will move on to Richard Kessler. His representative is the executive director from Center for Arts Education,
yes,
as well as Jeremy Johansson, executive director from New York State Alliance for Arts Education, and as well as Diane Aronson, the Arts in Education Program Manager from BOCES. We can begin.
Hi there. Yeah, Richard Kessler unfortunately was not able to make it this morning because of the snowstorm, but I'm here to speak on his behalf. My name is Jonathan Lewis. I'm a MA Arts Administration student at Teachers College and president of Student Advocates for the Arts. And I'm joined by colleagues from Columbia, Teachers College, and NYU. I'm just going to be very brief and very specific. Specifically, I've come today to urge the state legislature to support Senate Bill 5878 and Assembly Bill 8938, introduced by Senator Serrano and Assemblymember Engelbreit, respectively. Both of these legislators have played a leading role on this issue and are deserving of great thanks for their effort. We'll be circulating Mr. Kessler's testimony, but basically I just want to say that after all the efforts of the past 20 or so years, there are still many, many children who are being shortchanged the education they are entitled to by New York State law. The missing piece of the puzzle has been legislation to bolster and animate what New York State law already provides for. If you have ever thought that there is nothing more that can ever be done, you are wrong. We urge you to support these bills and give the state a real chance to guarantee a quality arts education for every student. You really can make a difference. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Please continue. Thank you for your presentation.
Good morning. My name is Jeremy Johannesson. I'm Executive Director of the New York State Alliance for Arts Education, which is the New York State affiliate of the Kennedy Center's Arts Education Network, and our organization represents VSA, the International Organization for Arts and Disabilities. These are undeniably difficult times and will require tough choices to be made. In the coming weeks, you and your legislative colleagues will be faced with the arduous task of allocating the state's scarce resources and developing policies that will impact the daily lives of all New Yorkers, including our students. As you tackle this work, you will no doubt be presented with volumes of information, facts, figures, and charts, each painstakingly designed to illuminate a specific course of action. As supporters of the arts, we'll certainly face challenges from those who will ask, how can we fund the arts when there is not enough funding for arts and health, for education and healthcare? For just a few moments, I invite you to put aside all the numbers and the carefully crafted messages and engage your imagination. Recall, if you will, the first time you were truly moved, engaged, impacted, changed by the arts. Be it a trip to a museum, attendance at a performance, a trip to the movies, or a song on the radio, I'm confident that each of you were touched by the arts, for if you weren't, you wouldn't be here today. Now imagine in New York where our students are not exposed and engaged in the arts and provided with a complete and vibrant arts education. A New York where the schools answer only to test scores in AYP. Kennedy Center President Michael Kaiser asked us to imagine the reaction of a parent of a third grader who would come home and report that she would not be studying math this year because her teacher isn't interested in math and didn't see how it applies to education. And yet we readily accept this for the arts. I ask each of you to be bold in your work and to keep the memories of how the arts have impacted your lives close at mind and consider these words of President John F. Kennedy. I look forward to an America which will reward achievement in the arts as we reward achievement in business or statecraft. I look forward to an America which will steadily raise the standard of artistic accomplishment and which will steadily enlarge cultural opportunities for all of our citizens. I look forward to an America which commands respect throughout the world, not only for its strength, but for its civilization as well. Thank you.
Okay, I'm Diane Aronson. I am a Arts and Education Program Manager for the DCMO and the ONC BOCES. And there are people who have a similar job description throughout New York State. For almost 25 years, NISCA has been partnering with local arts organizations and schools to help give all students access to quality performing visual and literary arts experiences. Initial partnerships evolved into substantial arts and education programming coordinated through BOCES, and grants for local capacity building and Empire State partnerships administered through NISCA. Our educators' most frequent comments are that most students in our rural schools would not otherwise have the opportunity to experience live performances, visit museums, or meet and work with artists. School districts sign up for the Arts and Education Service year after year. They see the arts as an essential part of educating the whole child. Our modern culture has vast amounts of media, saturated with performing arts, visual arts, and words. Students must be literate in all forms of communication and be able to think critically and creatively. The arts engage students. It is through the arts that students form personal meaning, exercise their imaginations, and express themselves. The arts are very necessary in order for students to become caring, thinking, and responsible human beings. What has been learned in 20-plus years of evidence-based research can best be summed up by this comment made by Sandra Rupert, director of a National Arts Education Partnership. In almost direct proportion to the extent that students are marginalized, disadvantaged, or at risk, the arts exert a powerful countervailing force that keeps them in school, points them towards success, and prepares them for creative and productive lives. The arts and collaborative partnerships with education will be especially important as we face lean and challenging times. I urge level funding for NISCA. Thank you for this opportunity to speak.
I thank you for bringing your message here, and I haven't really thought for a while, where did I first hear, where did I first get exposed to the arts when I was a kid? I'm not real sure I really have an answer to that. My mom was a dramatic soprano singer, and I was exposed every day to her practicing in the piano, and I sometimes ran from the house. But she also took me to, and I'm remembering this even as you were speaking, she took me to the St. Louis Museum of Art to see a complete exhibition of Van Gogh that had been gathered from the whole world. It was, I think it was 8. It blew me away. We need our kids in New York to have access to similar experiences. Thank you for bringing your message.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want to also just echo the sentiments of the assembly member, and also mention that the legislation that we're working on, the compliance legislation that you mentioned, I think is going to really, really help drive the point home about what a woeful job the state is doing as far as compliance with arts education. We've seen, I think, a similar problem with only 8% compliance in New York City. And as the assembly member mentioned, it leaves an impression on a young person. I mean, I could think about my years in grade school and growing up, and if you asked me to remember a particular social studies class or something, I don't know if I could remember. But if you asked me to think about the classes that I took for opera appreciation and listening to La Traviata, or going to different Philharmonic, being I grew up in New York City, we were able to do a lot of these field trips. And it did leave a very strong impression, but it also gave me a more of a greater appreciation for academics, for being in school, for all of the different things that make us more well-rounded students. you know, we're so focused on these standardized test scores and the ability or inability of students to achieve these scores. But we have undeniable data that shows that children that engage in music and arts education do better on other subjects. And it's unfortunate that as much as we know that, oftentimes we don't see that play itself out in education policy. So that's why it's important that you guys keep pushing this, because as we continue to shape and push education policy, the arts component has to be equal to math, readings, and sciences. That's my belief. But thank you very much for your remarks. Next, we will hear from Group 5, which is museums. We're going to hear from Stephen Kern, Director of the Everson Museum, and Ann Ackerman, Director of the Museum Association of New York. Thank you both for being here.
Thank you very much for having me come here. Senator Serrano, I've heard you speak about the arts before, and you're inspirational and eloquent, and your belief in what we do is absolutely essential for our welfare as professionals. Assemblymember Engelbreit, that was my first experience, and you recognize the transformational power of art that we are promoting every day, and it's good to know that it's not falling on deaf ears. Thank you. The Everson Museum of Art has an annual budget of approximately $2.5 million. The staff is already lean with fewer than 20 positions, yet productivity is high, with an ambitious exhibition program and extensive outreach for school children, families, at-risk and underserved audiences, and higher education. In line with national averages, nearly 50% of our annual budget goes to personnel costs. Income is pieced together from modest fees and ticketing, investment income, individual gifts and memberships, corporate underwriting, and county, state, and federal support. We can no longer absorb funding cuts in any single area. NISCA funding, for example, is one of our only reliable sources of general operating support and provides funding for both outreach and exhibition programs. Further decrease will result in reduction or even elimination of programs. This brings job cuts into play. No other alternatives. A Syracuse snapshot of what a museum can do. Last fall, the Everson presented blockbuster Turner de Cézanne, and we embraced the notion that it's easy to book an Impressionism show, but the proof of the pudding lies in what you do with it. The educational program for Turner de Cézanne took the Everson to a whole new level of community engagement, featuring unprecedented collaboration in our arts community and with cultural partners in music, performance, and history. These partnerships provided great opportunities for cultural cross-pollination and promotions, all to the benefit of local and visiting audiences. We also partnered with downtown Syracuse, businesses, hotels, and restaurants with our Chamber of Commerce and our Convention and Visitors Bureau, providing a valuable component to our tourist economy with the injection of millions of dollars. And as we at the museum alone welcome more than 60,000 visitors from across upstate, but also 30 states and 10 foreign countries. ABC News called the project a mini stimulus package for Syracuse, and the Buffalo News called it a collaborative masterpiece. This is what we can do. Recently, a visitor from Tully wrote to thank the Everson Board of Trustees. She wrote, "What an outstanding exhibit. At a time of economic difficulties, your decision to bring this exhibit was a bit risky. I'm grateful you had the forward-thinking vision to do this. We desperately needed such beauty and magnificence during these grim times. Bravo." We need state support to fulfill our mission. We need state support to serve your constituents. For every public dollar invested in the arts, approximately $10 returns to the New York state economy. Every dollar we receive from state, from NISCA, preserves jobs. This is good business. The governor's budget cuts say we cannot afford to support the arts. I say we cannot afford not to support the arts. Resources must be assured for the Everson, like all museums, like all arts organizations, to engage our community fully, to serve higher education, to be an active partner in economic development, and to be the cultural anchors that our neighborhoods, our city, and our region expect. I join New York State Arts in saying hold the line, and I join the Museum Association of New York in urging the state legislature to resist cuts proposed in Governor Patterson's 2010-2011 budget by holding funding at the current level of $41.6 million for NISCA, and to maintain tourist funding at levels of $14.2 million. We need them to exist. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you so much for your leadership, both Senator Serrano and Assemblymember Engelbright, for your leadership on arts and cultural and heritage issues in our state. It's very much appreciated. The Museum Association of New York is a member-based professional organization that fosters healthy museums and is based on good governance and leadership practices among the 1,900 museums and historical societies and historic houses that are across the state. We believe that the executive budget for 2010-11 includes disproportionately steep cuts for the programs that fund museums, heritage organizations, and living collections. Among them are the $6.5 million reduction to the local assistance of the New York State Council on the Arts, which you've heard so much about. But I think the real story here for NISCA is the cumulative effect that budget cuts and mid-year reductions have had on NISCA's capacity to provide critical operating and program support. In just 2 years, from 2008 to 2010, NISCA's local assistance budget has declined by 28%. The 44% reduction in funding to the zoos, botanical gardens, and aquariums program in the Environmental Protection Fund, the 25% reduction to tourism marketing programs, and of course the most recent proposal to close 14 or 39% of the state's operated historic sites. As you well know, the funding programs are a continuous source of critical capacity building, programmatic, and capital support that have no equal in the private sector. The Museum Association is here today to ask you, our state elected leaders, to resist these proposed reductions and to hold the line at this fiscal year's levels for every one of these programs. The Empire State is known for many things. One of them is its 1,900 museums and heritage organizations, many of them world-class institutions, all of them significant to their neighborhoods and their communities. They're central to the economic vitality of New York State and the education of its youth. They create community identity, they function as economic engines, and they provide educational opportunities for school children and their families that are not otherwise in many areas available. They're a key reason why tourism is the second largest industry in our state. And they are assets that won't be leaving New York for greener pastures elsewhere. The museum community has responded to diminishing corporate donations and shrinking endowments. In the face of these cutbacks, a recent survey by our association shows that visitation at New York's museums continued to grow from 31% in 2008 to 62.5% at the end of 2009. It does seem short-sighted to decrease or eliminate funding to institutions that are generating income for New York State every day. In difficult times, the maintenance of existing sources of state funding to museums and heritage organizations of all sizes is critical to sustaining superior performance and contributing to the state's bottom line. I think our focus right now is to ask you to lead us in stemming the tide of arts and cultural death by 1,000 cuts. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to just comment on something that Stephen said. About how we cannot afford to not fund the arts. And I think it's important to stress this because there are some who will push back against our efforts, other legislators, those in government, who will push back against what Steve and I are trying to do and say, well, if you're not willing to absorb cuts, you know, these are cuts across the board, the economy's bad, the entire state is suffering, the nation is suffering. How can you say no cuts to the arts? Well, we've done more than our share. I mean, if you look historically over the last 15, 20 years, funding for NISCA, funding for the arts in general has either dipped or remained flat. The funding levels have not kept pace with inflation. Looking at some numbers here from New York State Arts that we're approaching 1985 funding levels, that even in the best of times, I would say that the state has not done the right thing as far as funding for the arts, even in good economic times. And philanthropic support, as you mentioned, in a recession is going to dip. So you have this 1-2 punch for many arts organizations and museums that are leading to no other direction but, unfortunately, museums closing their doors. And once that happens, it's very difficult to get them open again. And how difficult will that be? How do we explain to our children that we're not going to provide that educational opportunity for them? So I challenge the commitment of Albany. I challenge the commitment even on the national level for the arts, because there will always be an excuse as to why we're not funding the arts the way they should, whether it be good times or bad. So I think that it's important that we keep this fight going, because we're willing to accept, I think, our share of the burden in this budget as much as anyone else. But we've had an undue burden for many, many years and continue to be sort of the one getting the really, really the short end of the stick in this budget.
I just wonder, do you have a sense of what the visitation pattern has been over the last year to the museums? Has it remained level? Has the dip in the economy caused a dramatic fall off in visitation? What's the pattern been?
Our polling has showed that visitation is up.
Visitation's up despite the fact that
we're in
a deep recession.
That's right. It's up 62% since 2008. So all that's been said here today about people staying closer to home, but traveling, but going to cultural venues is borne out in the numbers from our polls. Yeah.
And on a smaller scale, Syracuse alone, just at the Everson Museum, our numbers are approximately 10 times higher than they were last year. That speaks to a program that people are enjoying more, but also through the year, not just during peak exhibition periods, we see at least a three-time increase in the number of people coming to the museum.
Does this not reinforce the basic, does this pattern not reinforce the basic premise of what Senator Serrano said a moment ago?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Amen. I think it's important to look at the numbers. In state parks, up 2 million visitors. In the museums, up dramatic numbers. The way back economically is for people to feel good about living in New York and to reinvest themselves into the premise that this is the place to raise their families and to have a good quality of life. They're seeking that, it seems to be, when they go to our parks and they visit our museums in increasing numbers. They're trying to seek a new equilibrium and a sense of optimism. Optimism is what drives the economy. When people feel good, they'll buy a new refrigerator or television, which creates jobs and enables everything to start to feel like a good time has once again come to our economy. The way out of this is the arts, and Franklin Roosevelt knew that. That's why he supported the arts, CCC projects in the parks. I don't think we're making a mistake to say that we're going to fight to restore the funding for the arts. I believe it is going to help lift the spirits of our citizens and get this economy back on track.
I think that current research that we're working on right now is showing that, at least for museums and heritage organizations at any rate, for every dollar New York State spends or invests in those institutions through these various programs, about $550 is returned into the state's coffers in one way or another, or just turned into the state's economy in one way or other. So it's a good investment.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much, both of you, for being here. Next, we're going to see some YouTube videos. We were able to show some YouTube videos last year, at last year's hearing, of people who weren't able to join us here in Albany. So this year, we've received even more. We have a preview of some of them. And after the hearing, the assembly member and I will be responding to each YouTube video individually so that everyone gets a specific voice for me and Steve, and that we can respond to each accordingly. So let's roll the YouTube clips.
Thank you, Chairman Serrano and committee members, for this opportunity to testify. Others follow after my question. My name is Judith Escalona. I'm the executive director of PRDream.com and Media Noche, a digital gallery and digital film studio located in East Harlem, also known as El Barrio. Our question is twofold. Has the New York State Senate and Assembly lobbied President Obama and the U.S. Congress to allocate more funding for the arts as a way of creating jobs and stimulating our local economies? And is there a way of directing some of the current federal initiatives for jobs and small businesses to artists and arts organizations? Again, thank you.
Hi. My name is Kiara Sanabria, and arts in the community is especially important for kids like me. Organizations such as Writers' Scene, PR Dream, and Media Noche create projects that teach us a lot and introduce us to the arts.
My name is Charlotte Gruen, and I am a student in the New York City public school system. Art is a means of expression, be it music, dance, mural making, or storytelling that unites everyone regardless of race, language, point of view, or any other thing that could be considered a separation in today's world. All in all, we are looking at an expression of a feeling or a scene or an idea together, and we are all trying to interpret it and relate it to ourselves, creating a common experience.
Hi, my name is Cindy Sanabria, president and founder of an independent guerrilla filmmaking production company named Write a Scene. Also collaborating on projects with Media Noche and PR Dream. Art is very meaningful. It is a creative outlet, a way to express ourselves as individuals. It is imperative for companies such as ours and others to be allowed to continue to flourish, because a world without art would be like a body with no life.
My name is Jose Antonio Icuria, curator of the International Poetic Short Film Festival, held annually at the Neo Rican Poets Cafe. I was born and raised in the Bronx, 1950s, and lived through the 60s and 70s, drugs, crime, gangs, and I
Can we raise the volume up a little bit? Control room?
Credit my survival to an arts program when I was like 16, 17 years old. An arts program in South Bronx where I learned painting, sculpting, photography, filmmaking. And that stuff stayed with me. And if it wasn't for that, I don't think I would have survived.
It's going to be hip. It's going to be fun. It's going to be, you know, the creative spot.
I see this part of the town turning around, and it's something everybody wants to be a part of.
When I think about where is the center of artistic creativity right now in Syracuse and into the future, it's here on the Near West Side.
There's an art scene that is starting to emerge.
I can see that it's coming together from a bunch of different angles, and it's got support and it's got energy.
You're about an hour or two from most of the major cities around Syracuse, so it's a great home base.
Everything to make this successful, it's all here. It's happening right now. Right now.
Hi, my name is Colleen Wolpert. I'm a photographer and visual artist. The standard of living is such that I can afford a place to live and a place to make my art.
This is the opportunity of a lifetime for an artist.
It's a much more interesting and rewarding experience to build your own path instead of moving to a city with pre-established niches that you fit your way into.
I'm Michael John Haggerty, and I rep about potatoes.
Red House Arts Center is a unique environment. We have film, theater, music, and a visual art gallery.
The first time that I came to the Gear Factory, I knew this was something that I wanted to be a part of.
I play in a band here called The Pilot Lies. We have a rehearsal room here. The Gear Factory is great place to be loud.
You come in, you hear three different bands playing, and it's just like the building becomes alive. We are musicians, artists, and we really feed off each other. The energy helps to push our own work.
Toronto, Boston, New York City, all these cities are within a few hours of Syracuse.
And because Syracuse has potential, it's one of those places that's developing and growing. You can hatch new ideas and really get them going because it's a blank slate in a sense.
There's a lot of positive things going on.
Salt District is really located, like, central to all these things, and it's super flat, super walkable. My wife and I decided to buy a dollar house down the near west side of the Salt District. It's only a dollar.
I've had discussions with my wife because we've been looking for a new place to move into, a bigger house, because we have two young kids. And the Salt District is definitely something we really want to be a part of.
Hi, my name is Shay Gines. I'm one of the executive directors of the Innovative Theater Foundation, celebrating off-off-Broadway and independent theater. I want to thank you for this opportunity to address you in regards to our community. An estimated 500 theater companies, which makes it one of the largest arts communities in the world and the foundation of New York theater. Yet it is continually overlooked in terms of funding and state and federal support. New York theater is a destination for audiences and artists from across the country and around the world. With nearly 1,800 productions every year, Off-Off-Broadway creates opportunities for these artists to practice their art more than any place else. The governor's proposed $6.5 million budget cut to the arts represents a minuscule percentage of the New York state budget, but that money is the lifeblood for these small arts organizations. And these cuts would be devastating to the Off-Off-Broadway community. $1,000 to an Off-Off-Broadway theater company is the difference between doing a production or not doing a production. And $6.5 million represents half of the Off-Off-Broadway season. We cannot afford these cuts. I would also like to ask you to consider the tax abatement proposal that is being put forward by the Manhattan Community Boards that offers tax breaks to landlords that either donate or offers a below market value rent to nonprofit theater companies. Over the last 6 years, Off-Off-Broadway has seen 26% of their spaces either demolished to make way for developments or repurposed into non-performance spaces. With increasing rents and taxes, the remaining spaces are often priced outside the budget for these already cash-strapped theater companies. The tax abatement proposal offers an innovative solution that benefits the landlords, the theater companies, and the cultural capital of New York State. An investment in Off-Off-Broadway is an investment in New York. Thank you.
Thank you. So, like I mentioned before, we will be getting to all of those YouTube videos and others that you didn't see there. And we will now move on to the next group, correct? We're going to be listening to group number 6, which is going to cover the issues of performing arts. We have Dan Hart, who's the executive director of the Buffalo Philharmonic, Charles Owen, president and CEO of Rochester Philharmonic. We'll also have up Paul Malloy, Associated Musicians of Greater New York, and David Morris, chair of the New York State Theater Institute. So we'll begin with Dan and Charles.
Good afternoon. I'm Charlie Owens, the president and CEO of the Rochester Philharmonic. This is the orchestra the great George Eastman founded 87 years ago. I'm proud to be joined here by my upstate colleague, Dan Hart, president and CEO of the Buffalo Philharmonic. On behalf of the millions of upstate residents who support and attend and are enriched by our orchestras, we would like to thank both Senator Serrano and Assemblyman Engelbreit for holding this important meeting today. So while the state of New York and you as our elected representatives negotiate large deficits in the midst of the economic crisis, we come today to let you know that the effects of economic turmoil go far beyond Albany and are being felt directly and drastically by organizations such as ours. Last year, despite cost-cutting measures across the board, the RPO ended its 2009 year with a $776,000 deficit, almost 8% of our total budget. Should say here at the outset, without the support of NISCA at the $250,000 level, our deficit would have exceeded $1 million last year. And of course, we are extremely grateful for their support, you know, especially in this difficult economy. So this year, in the wake of this crisis, we reduced our budget by $1 million, a full 10%. including reductions in the salaries and benefits of our musicians and our staff, totaling more than $500,000. So last year's deficit was a result of three economy-related factors: declines in contributions, declines in ticket sales, and a decline in the value of our own endowment. So just a couple of quick examples. In a typical year, 6,500 families contribute charitable gifts to our annual campaign, totaling about $2.5 million. Last year, in the wake of the recession, we lost 1,900 of the prior year donors altogether, 28% of our donor base. Our box office, not surprisingly, also took a hit as discretionary spending pattern changed, even from our most loyal, longtime patrons. So compounding the problem of last year's deficit is that that brings our organization's total debt accumulation over the past 20 years to nearly $3 million. Right now, that debt is paralyzing our organization's growth, and it goes without saying we cannot sustain further cuts without considering a change in our mission altogether. And that's a mission that truly serves our community. The RPO provides free concerts to more than 20,000 school children every year. In a day and age, as you well know, when music programs are being cut or drastically curtailed in many schools, many of the children in our inner city would not be able to experience music without our direct and active partnership with school districts, not only in the city of Rochester, but throughout our nine-county region. Beyond the programs for young people are tens of thousands of families and seniors who experience our programs every year, often at free or deeply discounted rates. Without the ability to serve these audiences, our mission would be drastically altered. So all of us here today, of course, know that organizations like ours contribute directly to the quality of life in our communities. And as has been noted, we also serve a critical economic role in the heart of our center cities. In a single season alone, it's estimated that the total annual spending by our organization of $10 million supports more than 360 jobs in our region. And in turn, that spending, those jobs, generate more than $1 million additional dollars in revenue for state and local government alone. You look at the economic development of our patrons, or the impact of our patrons. They buy about $2.5 million of tickets to downtown Rochester performances and spend another $2.5 million in our local cafes, restaurants, parking garages, and hotels. You know, this is measurable economic vitality in our center city. So in summary, the very spirit and essence of the RPO is being threatened. Our organization, and by extension our community, is being compromised by these proposed cuts in the NISCA budget. I ask you to make a direct investment in the spirit of optimism and hope for Rochester and cities like ours across the state by restoring the vital funds that NISCA and other agencies need to support the work of the RPO and other cultural organizations. Without that, we can't do what we do best: present music that enriches our lives, inspires our children, and adds economic vitality to our center cities. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today.
Hi, thank you for your time. Dan Hart from Buffalo Philharmonic. And I think we speak for our colleagues at the Syracuse Symphony as well in coming here today to address the panel. When we compare notes, it's almost identical. We have a mirror image of what's happening in Rochester and Western New York. Revenues are down. This past year and a half has been a perfect storm, and we're besieged on all sides by lower ticket sales, endowment earnings, and contributions. And so when you compare notes, it's almost like you could just substitute Buffalo or Syracuse for everything Charlie says. We've cut $800,000 from our budget. We've reduced the weeks of employment for our musicians. We've cut our staff by 25%. We've taken pay cuts. And so further erosion of this from the NISCA allocation that we get each year would have a pretty severe impact on us. I mean, we've been in a period of consolidation for almost 20 years now. And we are still continuing each of our orchestras in our communities to reach hundreds of thousands of people. We're doing our jobs in spite of lower budgets. And I just have to say that the support from NISCA has been very important in our ability to serve our organizations and our communities. And we really support full funding. We hope that you can keep it the funding level. I think that. Finally, the zoo say don't monkey with our funding. I guess we would have to say don't fiddle around with our funding, no. Please.
Thank you. You want to go next? Yeah.
Yes. Chairman Serrano, Chairman Englebright, thank you for convening this hearing. My name is Paul Malloy, and I'm the political director of the American Federation of Musicians Local 802. We represent over 8,500 professional musicians and teaching artists who play a vital role in the cultural life of our city and state. Like you, we're concerned about the economic health of our state and the health of the entertainment, arts, and cultural industries that we work in. I'll briefly address four topics on this subject. In 2005, 2,628 organizations statewide identified themselves as nonprofit cultural institutions. Now, in an average year, NISCA issues grant money to about 2,600 of them. In that same year, those organizations generated nearly $8 billion in economic activity, over 50,000 jobs, $3 billion in wages, and over $250 million in tax revenue to Albany. And all this came from an arts budget that is 1/32nd of 1% of the state budget. I'll repeat that. The state arts budget is 1/32nd of 1% of the state's budget. Cutting 15% of the NISCA budget after two mid-year cuts last year is exactly the wrong choice now. To do so is short-sighted, economically harmful, and in terms of closing a budget gap, meaningless. We must reject the myth that we must choose between the arts and economic prosperity. Both are intertwined. Like the hospitality and real estate industries, the creative industries are economic assets. In other words, arts equal jobs. Arts equal ancillary spending in other sectors. Statewide in 2005, arts-motivated tourists contributed $5.8 billion to the economy. And that includes expenditures on food, travel, lodging, and shopping. Therefore, we urge the legislature to keep the NISCA budget at its current funding level. Second, the state's arts curriculum must be taught equally in all our public schools. A Wallace Foundation study verified that the benefits for school children participating in arts programs include improvements in academic performance, critical thinking, and understanding that one's behavior has consequences. 2 years ago, New York City's Department of Education acknowledged that 92% of its elementary school children were not getting instruction in all four art forms each year. Last year, that number dropped to 88%. And at this rate, we can expect full compliance by 2032. But noncompliance isn't limited to the five boroughs. Therefore, we encourage passage of the Arts Education Compliance and Equity Act. These children are New York's and the nation's future leaders, innovators, artists, and arts patrons, and we should guarantee them the well-rounded education they deserve. Third, the Empire State Film Production Tax Credit is an unqualified success. Film and television shoots between April and December of 2008 generated $1.8 billion in spending. That's double the rate of spending on film and television projects from the previous year. However, we dropped the ball in 2004 by not creating a post-production tax credit. Post-production is animation, sound effects, editing, and scoring. Now, currently, it's a qualifying expense when 75% of a project is shot in-state. However, if a project is shot in Argentina or New Jersey and the producers want the post-production work done here, we have no incentive for them. Now, Connecticut and Massachusetts took notice, and they've been reaping the financial benefits of our costly omission for a number of years. These jobs are highly portable, and because of the way our tax credit is currently written, many projects are shot in New York but scored in Prague or edited in LA. And we've already got the talent and infrastructure for this work, so let's get those jobs back to New York. To do so, we urge the legislature to create an inclusive and competitive tax credit program that includes post-production, writers' and composers' salaries as qualifying costs, and encompasses commercial and advertising work, and interactive multimedia, that's the grown-up phrase for video games, whose budgets are competitive with film budgets. Lastly, a word on employee misclassification. This criminal behavior by illegal employers siphons billions from the state economy. I've attached to my testimony a letter from Suffolk County DA Tom Spoda, who offers four compelling proposals to go after illegal employers who enrich themselves at the expense of our children's future. Please consider his thoughts and any existing employee misclassification legislation. If we can modify our labor laws and bring back these billions in urgently needed gap-closing revenue, we'll never have to have these types of hearings again where we're begging for the right to earn a living in our industries. Instead, we'll be talking about how we can expand these arts programs. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me to come here today and speak on behalf of the New York State Theater Institute Corporation. Although I'm at the bottom of the page of the speakers here today, that doesn't make me feel bad at all. I'm honored, frankly, to be here with this group, and I think someone on your staff must have found out that in the fourth and fifth grade, I was a terrific tonette player. And that's the last musical instrument that I ever mastered. So to be here But this group is a lot of fun, and I appreciate the opportunity. As I did in front of the Finance Committee, I want to introduce to you the many of our company members and interns who are here in the audience with the now famous New York State Theater Institute t-shirts. And if you'd stand up just to show everybody who you are. I was supposed to bring my t-shirt today too, but I forgot about it. I know Assemblyman Engelbreit and Senator Serrano, I know you both are aware of what the New York State Theater Institute is. I've spoken to both of you before. The full content of my remarks, you're all getting copies of. There are a few things, though, that I would like to take the liberty of repeating, and a couple of new things that I did not know about, and you didn't either, I'm sure, when we last spoke. The activities of the Theater Institute, both domestic and international, are well known and widely respected. A year ago, we were invited to the Swedish Consulate in New York City to accept a citation on behalf of the New York State Theater Institute from the Swedish ambassador and bring him greetings on behalf of New York State. NYSTI's exchange of artists from the Swedish theater group Teater Vestmanland brought a different culture to our audiences, another example of NYSTI's work towards mutual understanding. Last year, the Children's Theater Foundation of America honored the New York State Theater Institute and its producing artistic director, Patricia DiBenedetto Snyder, in New York with its prestigious Medallion Awards. Dr. Snyder went down to accept her individual award, and I went down to accept the medallion on behalf of the New York State Theater Institute. The association subsequently elected Dr. Snyder to its board of directors. Through some error, they overlooked electing me to their board of directors, but I just have to go along with that anyway. You understand, I know you know, that under the governor's proposed budget, without notice and without any consultation from the Office of Budget or the Governor's Office, our budget will be cut in half this year and next year would be eliminated. More bad news, as if that isn't bad enough. The Governor's budget amendment, which was issued on February 9th, 2010, eliminated another $250,000 from the proposed budget for 2010-11. NYSTI is basically eliminated if this action is permitted to be passed by the legislature, or if it is passed by the legislature. I know I read a list to you when I testified before of the impact of the ending of the New York State Theater Institute. Termination of 33 full-time employees, termination of 100 part-time teachers, artists, and craftspeople. City of Troy, Capital District, and surrounding upstate counties will lose the benefits of NYSTI from direct purchase of goods and services, and the annual NYSTI audience of 40,000 people will no longer patronize local businesses. The new fact, the Americans for the Arts Economic Prosperity Calculator estimates NYSTI's expenditures and audiences together create over $4 million of economic impact in the capital region when our total budget is $3 million. To eliminate $3 million and eliminate $4 million makes no sense at all. The governor's failure to bring us to the table last year resulted in an expensive amount of time spent by the legislature and by NYSTI's personnel. And the legislature, we are eternally grateful, saved us. We ask that that happen again. And we ask that the governor's budget not be approved and that our budget be restored, subject, of course, to a reasonable reduction, which we are prepared to accept. But 50% plus a quarter of a million isn't reasonable. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think it was Paul, you mentioned about the post-production missed opportunity that we have here, and I agree. And Assemblymember Engelbreit and I are co-sponsoring together in both our respective houses legislation that would create a pilot program for a post-production tax credit of $7 million. And we hope to attract that industry more to New York. I mean, I think it's unfortunate that over the years we've lost so much of the production and post-production where we once were. We were once we had many studios. We had a lot of work here, and we've lost so much of that, not only to California, but to Toronto and to other areas where it's more favorable. The economics are more favorable. So just wanted to let you know and the audience know that working on that, we're looking for support for that bill. Steve?
Thanks to each of you for, you know, braving the weather to be here to share your message with us. And I just have a sort of a general question for the Philharmonics. What you're describing is ominous. You're accumulating debt, suffering various indignities budgetarily. What is your short and long-term strategy is the first part of the question. And the second part is, to what extent is NISCA able to participate if they are restored in enabling you to weather this storm?
Well, I guess I can talk a little bit about our short-term strategy. I mean, the recession hit so fast that there was really no chance to implement any kind of short-term strategy except budget cuts. It's the most unfortunate kind because it hits people in their pocketbooks. Our musicians are not like the New York Philharmonic or Philadelphia Orchestra making over $100,000 a year. These are people that are making $40,000 a year, and we've continued to cut their salaries. We've gone from 87 full-time musicians in Buffalo to 73 over the past 15 years. Our work weeks have gone from 46 to 37. So what's going to, if this is not corrected, we're going to see just a continued deterioration of what we offer to the community. So short term, the only strategy you had was to cut expenses. Now as we look at trying to recover from this, we've tried all kinds of things in terms of pricing to get people back in the hall, challenged grants to get contributed revenue back up, increased fundraising for endowments. So we're not resting on NISCA's case to solve our problems. It's just an important component of our problems. And I think the best example of the importance of NISCA has been that, there's a perception that orchestras and philharmonics are kind of elitist organizations. But in fact, what NISCA has done through the funding that we have received is that we've been able to expand our mission and expand our programs to really serve the entire community. Right now in Buffalo, we serve more children K through 12 than we have coming to our classical concerts. Over 35,000 kids come. That's because we have a level of funding from NISCA that basically gives us the opportunity to do that kind of outreach. We have more people coming to free concerts during the summer than we have come to our classical series. So that's what NISCA does for us. I mean, it really enables the BPO and orchestras like ours to really reach out into every corner of our community, and that's why it's so important.
It enables you to touch more lives, is what you're saying.
Yes.
Yeah, that's very well said. I think the other thing I would add that beyond the budget cuts, I said we've cut 10% out of the budget just this year, and like the BPO, we've been on a 20-year reduction from a 52-week contract back in the early 80s now to a 37-week contract this year, and $37,000 of base wage for our players. But an economy also, a situation like this can also be an opportunity to inspire us to seek new partnerships. We were talking upstairs in the offices of one of our delegation members about opportunities for the upstate orchestras to collaborate programmatically. The recession has impacted museums in Rochester, and for example, the Strong National Museum of Play, the George Eastman House. We've all been working closely together to find ways to connect our two organizations to build audiences. And sometimes I actually think the organizations have done a tremendous job of making lemonade out of the indignities, as you describe them, of the economy and the budget cuts.
I remember some years ago I had an opportunity to spend a week in Rochester visiting just a fraction, really, of the cultural institutions in this great city. I was enormously impressed. George Eastman House, a strong museum, which was in boxes at that time, and the Memorial Gallery, and on. It's just an impressive city. We're going to do what we can. We thank you very much for bringing your message here today in support of, especially I think it's poignant that you're here, given the difficulties that the incoming missiles of the morning that you're enduring, to take the time to come here to speak on behalf of the arts for the whole state. It's very impressive. Thank you so much.
Well, we appreciate the invitation and your advocacy. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have one more panel, and then we will have our grand finale. Group number seven, is also dealing with performing arts, and we are going to hear from Boza Rivers, who's the chair of the Harlem Arts Alliance, as well as Steve Sterling, president of the Recording Academy New York chapter. We'll begin with Boza. Thank you for being with us.
Good afternoon, Chairman Engelbreit and Chairman Serrano and members of the committee. I'm pleased to return once again to request sustained funding for the New York State Council of the Arts. I'm also here today as Chairman of the Arts and Culture Committee of the Greater Harlem Chamber of Commerce, a 113-year-old membership organization with 2,000-plus members from small mom-and-pop businesses to Fortune 100 companies, and also as chairman of the Harlem Arts Alliance, representing more than 700-plus members rooted in the creative community of Harlem to support the continued work of the artistic and creative communities. Last year when I was here, we were 400 members, and this year, the Harlem Arts Alliance now has 700. Today, we came with representatives from the borough of New York City, including the Northern Manhattan Arts Alliance, the Cultural Equity Group, the Caribbean Cultural Center, the Westchester Arts Alliance, the Coalition of Theaters of Color, and visual and performing artists. As a cultural service organization, the Harlem Arts Alliance has an added responsibility to underscore that those artists and arts and cultural institutions do not exist in a vacuum, that they are an integral part of their communities. The state budget is faced with enormous challenges to balance its budget and reduce spending. Our members and colleagues in the arts community are also working to balance budgets and reduce spending. We recognize that government and artists and arts institutions are all vulnerable during times of economic tension caused by severe gaps in state funding for the arts. My colleague Norma Munn, and I know that earlier Senator Serrano referred to it, said that the 1985 State Arts Council budget for local assistance was $35.3 million. In fiscal year 2011, the proposed budget is around $35 or $38 million for local assistance. It appears that we are truly moving back to the future. Reduced funding for the New York State Council on the Arts will mean staff reductions, elimination of services to the community, limited programming, and more closed cultural institutions in our community. We believe our community's health and vitality are at stake, and we are standing on fragile ground. We know that our culture counts, our artists and cultural institutions count, and we're counting on you to ensure that level funding is a high priority on your agenda for NISCA. In closing, we urge you to please work together and restore significant funding to NISCA so that it can help continue to help us make a difference.
Thank you. My name is Steve Sterling. I'm president of the New York chapter of the Recording Academy, also known as the National Academy of Recording Arts and Sciences. I thank you for making this forum available for all of us. It's quite a group here today, and I'm fully aware that in this forum we're really preaching to the converted. Yes. And I want to say thank you, especially Senator Serrano and Assemblyman Engelbert, because you
I don't know if you know this in purpose, but what I've realized here is you're, by assembling everybody together in a building and moving through the halls, you are actually doing a great job at coalescing a lot of us who are also working against a number of very well-organized corporations that can fund lobbyists and have a lot of other resources to pour into their interests. I've also become very aware that everyone is special and everyone has interests. There's a lot of special interests going, and these are very, very difficult times. I do want to share you with you that our organization, the Recording Academy, the New York chapter specifically, we have members throughout New York State. Our group, almost 4,000 members in the New York area, our app chapter area, our songwriters, composers, performers, producers, mixers, engineers. We employ a lot of people. We're very much part of the multiplier effect. I want to be very clear. We are a membership-funded organization. Many people know us as the Recording Academy, which puts up the Grammy Awards, and that's definitely a big high-profile event that we do every year. But through that, we spend a tremendous amount of time and resource doing Grammy U for university students. We do Grammy Career Day in New York City, which typically brings 600 or 800 tri-state area New York City schools together, students, where we can tell them that there is a career and there's a future for their passion and their interest somewhere in the entertainment, arts, and sciences areas. And I want to be very clear that we put a lot of effort and our own money into that. So I'm not here today with a tin cup, but we are here to coattail on a lot of organizations that you're listening to and are very supportive of, to say that we understand on two ends of this. The education part, there's a huge return on investment. I think that's a scientific fact now, very quantitative. I don't think anybody can have any dispute about that. The return on investment at the school level for arts is tremendous now, and it has to be embraced, even if I dare say to the exclusion of some other very difficult choices that you all have to make here in this building. The other part is we do a lot of career development for our members and others. We make a lot of that available to other people who are not our members because we believe strongly that offering career development to people who may be out in the industry or making changes is also a very important investment in the future. I want to say, and I want to be brief here because I do respect your time. It's been very precious to all of us. You walk around here and you definitely feel the undertone of people wanting to look at you and say money doesn't grow on trees. I think we're all very well aware that money does not grow on trees. But what does grow on trees are seeds. And those seeds that grow on trees become other trees. And it's very, very important that you keep this going to the point, and as I dare say, to the exclusion of very difficult choices, because everybody that's come to you today is influencing the quality of people's lives. And we've all been able to make the case that if you want to apply something more quantitative than that, we're also affecting jobs. We're also affecting employment. We're all doing everything we can to keep that other special part of people's lives intact. And we very much appreciate what you're doing, and we very much appreciate that you've given us a forum for all of us to get together. I have a lot of colleagues here today who have taken off from work, have left their jobs today to come up and work the halls. Many of them are in meetings now. So we very much appreciate what you're doing, and we're very interested in hearing any advice you can give us. We understand that to some people, this is a very not so coalesced group of interests here. But you're doing a great thing by gathering us together and letting us get ourselves more together so we can be more impactful for these important issues. So I thank you very much.
I'm glad you asked. If we had any advice, be difficult to offer advice if somebody hadn't asked for it. But you asked.
And we're interested.
You know, if you don't ask, you don't get in the world that we're in. So ask, all of you, please, talk to your elected representatives, most particularly your state representatives. Use the newspapers. I know everybody is fully engaged with computers these days, but newspapers, particularly on days like this, people will read the ink off of the paper. They will read from front to back, and they will stop and read the letters to the editor. Talk to the editors, too. Send them letters. Be in support of your local arts organizations as well as the state support for those local arts organizations through the Council on the Arts, and then go talk to them. Talk to your editors. Remind them of the things you're telling us and urge them to put those very thoughts on their editorial pages and to send their reporters out to tell the story that is the essence of your testimony to us. Politicians clip newspapers, and they will read, and you will have your message heard and seen in a stereophonic kind of way. It will be coming from numerous sources. And it doesn't cost a lot of money to do that. It does take time and attention. But when you meet with your local state representative, here is useful, back home is useful, come with a crowd of people who are constituents. And if you want to be scientific about this, go online and look who made donations to them and see if any of them are members of your organizations and bring them with. Mm-hmm. And that will really get their attention if they're ever so gently reminded that these are individuals who have invested into the premise that underlies their reason for being in office. And don't be shy about carrying your message redundantly. Redundancy is good. And is part of the reality. We get 53,000 pages of correspondence every day, which is why you need to come back again and again with your message and make sure that ever so nicely you are able to remind your elected representatives of the role that they can play, not just for yourselves, but for the organizations, and indeed, you are their constituency. So I'm glad you asked. Thank you for giving me the opportunity.
I thank you for your practical advice. We know we're up against a lot of resources, and the one thing that I know from being in this business a long time is passion trumps everything, and you're exactly right. If we can harness this passion and collect it together and coalesce it, we can definitely make a kind of impact, and that's what we need to do, because everybody you've heard from today is so passionate about what they do. We're not all making a lot of money in what we do. I'm a volunteer in what I do and what I'm doing here today, but we know that that's very important, and we have to raise the bar, and I thank you for that input. Absolutely. Thank you.
Speaking about elected officials, we would normally have a number of other elected officials joining us here, but as we all know, we're in budget season. Mm-hmm. Many members are at conference. They wanted to get down. We had a couple of members who were here before. But they have a very strong interest in what we've done here today. And we will have this video up as a link on our website, and we will also put it onto a DVD and get it out to all the members of both committees, as well as any other member who would be interested in this, because as the assembly member pointed out, it's all great that we said all this today, but what next? And I think the what next is that we take all of this energy and the relationships that we're forming here, and the organizations are meeting one another, and we're going to galvanize what we've done here today and continue to spread this message at the right time, because now our backs are up against the wall for this mm-hmm. budget, and we have to make a compelling argument for the arts, for the cultural sector, for our museums and zoos, and a compelling argument for the transformative effect that these industries have on communities, the jobs they provide, and the jobs that we will lose and the deeper hole we will dig ourselves in this recession if we don't do the right thing by the arts. With that, I will thank this panel for being with us. We are about to reach the end of this wonderful session, but not without hearing from a very important guest. We have with us Heidi Scope, who is a veteran of the Metropolitan Opera, voice teacher, master technician. We're going to hear a few words from Heidi and also a performance to help drive the message home to everyone.
Can I just say one word?
I'm going to review the film, the video that's being done here because I have to leave now. I'm sorry. I apologize. I have to go out and advocate for restoration of the parks on radio. And I have to be there in 13 and a half minutes. Thank you all so very much for giving me a chance to get my batteries recharged by hearing your message today. Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Tell you about resonance, if I may. Good afternoon, Chairman Serrano and Engelbreit and other distinguished members of the Senate and Assembly Arts Committees. Thank you so much for the opportunity to appear before your committees this afternoon. My name is Heidi Skoke, and I am the founder and artistic director of Resonance, Albany Singer Intensive Festival. And I'm joined today by Diana Hernandez, our executive director, who is also my founding partner of Resonance. Resonance is a not-for-profit arts organization that nurtures young opera singers of great promise from around the country, as well as from New York's Capital District region. Each summer, Resonance hosts a 3-week summer intensive workshop here in the Capital District. The workshop provides young opera singers the opportunity to study with a nationally renowned faculty that includes staff from the Metropolitan Opera, which is my home opera house, Houston Grand Opera, Los Angeles Opera, and the Juilliard School. Workshop participants also gain vital on-stage experience through a series of public performances in which they perform a diverse operatic program to live accompaniment. This past summer, the concert series was held at the Massery Center for the Arts at the College of St. Rose in Albany. I'm most happy to say that each of the performances was very well attended, which shows that opera indeed has an audience in the Capital Region. This past summer, singers from Clifton Park, Niskayuna, and Del Mar, and from as far away as Oregon, California, and Texas, participated in Resonance. We have been so fortunate in having an incredibly diverse group of singers from a broad range of backgrounds. This coming summer, we plan to offer scholarships to select talented students who might otherwise not be able to participate in the workshop due to financial constraints. We are tremendously excited by the opportunity that Resonance offers to young singers. I was so fortunate to sing at the Metropolitan Opera for 12 years, mostly under the baton of Maestro James Levine, first as a young artist in the Young Artist Program there, now known as the Lindemann Program, and then as a performing artist with the company. This could not have happened without all of the training, support, and encouragement of my teachers. And it is my vision to now help other young artists by providing this type of training, support, and encouragement through Resonance. Like any other not-for-profit arts organization, Resonance could not exist without the support and generosity of individual donors, as well as corporate and foundation grants. But perhaps the most crucial funding source is provided by New York's legislature, which has had the foresight and commitment to generously fund the arts, even in times of financial hardship. Today, we thank you so much for that support. With the help of state funding, Resonance will continue to brighten the lives of young singers and all those who enjoy the artistic possibilities of the human voice. We thank you so much.
Thank you very much for your testimony, and thanks for being here and for all that you do for this region here. And we look forward to hearing what you're going to do now.
Okay. Shall I step up here? I don't need a microphone.
Yeah. Okay.
That's all. You don't think I need a microphone? You tell me if I do. I wanted to have a pianist come today. He was going to bring his Yamaha Clavinova, and due to the weather, he decided that wasn't so wise for him. So I will sing a cappella for you today. You can hopefully imagine the music that I'm hearing in my head. Try to. This is from Carmen, Lake George Opera, which is just a hop, skip, and a jump away from us. They're going to perform this summer. It's by Georges Bizet, and it's Prêt en Carmen. Well, that was a treat. Thank you very much, Heidi, for doing that on short notice, for being with us today. It was a tremendous honor and a privilege to hear you perform. And with that grand finale, ladies and gentlemen, we will conclude the 2010 Art State Joint Committee meeting. And I want to thank Assemblymember Engelbright, and I'll thank him when I see him, for co-chairing this committee, and all of my staff, Greg Meyer, and everyone who helped to put this together, and all of the advocates, most importantly, because we have to really redouble our efforts to save the arts in this state. Thank you so much for being here. God bless you all. Thank you. Yeah.